Well, hey guys, in today's video, I'm going to be talking about cosmetic procedures to fix droopy hooded eyelids. If you're new here, welcome. My name is Andrea. I'm a board certified dermatologist. I would love it if you would subscribe to my YouTube channel and hit the thumbs up. It really helps my videos out a lot. Hooded or droopy eyelids are the result of age-related change to the face. You guys know that as we age, we lose collagen in the deeper layers of our skin and elastin, and that results in saggy skin. But the other major factor that goes into play with the aging face and droopy eyelids is loss of bone, redistribution of fat, and redistribution of kind of muscles that ultimately also contributes to the appearance of droopy eyelids. So it's more than just losing collagen in the deeper layers of the skin. It's just kind of a restructuring of the facial anatomy and the anatomy around the eye. However, some people are born with naturally hooded eyelids, just secondary to their facial anatomy. And so they may be bothered by this at a younger age. It has nothing to do with age-related change to their face. In some cases of hooded eyelids, it's so severe that it impacts the individual's vision, especially like their peripheral vision. The hooded eyelids can actually weigh down the upper lashes and compromise your visual fields, and it also can lead to a lot of headaches. Procedure number one is an upper lid blepharoplasty, or basically surgery or a lid lift. Of all the procedures I'm going to chat with you guys about in today's video, this is the most invasive. It is done under local anesthesia. Blepharoplasty involves removing excess skin, bulging fat, and lax muscle tissue from the eye in order to correct the droopy hooded eyelid. The procedure runs $2,000 to $5,000. But if you are somebody whose visual fields have been impacted by your droopy eyelids, your insurance might actually cover a portion of the procedure. But there are actually no real contraindications to this procedure. Now, as with any surgery, of course, there are the potential risks of complications. No surgeon worth their weight would ever tell you, oh yeah, this surgery is complication-free. There's no such thing. So your surgeon will chat with you about potential complications. They're probably going to mention the most common complication from this procedure is uneven folds, folds that are inappropriately too high or too low. And this complication actually is correctable by having a second surgery. Some patients experience something called lag ophthalmos after the procedure. That's basically an inability to completely close the eye. And this can happen if too much tissue is removed. It can be a temporary thing, however, and it can resolve on its own. And there are some measures that, you know, could be recommended to mitigate some of the symptoms of not being able to close your eye fully. You may not even really notice it, but with time that could lead to dry eyes and problems with the cornea. Some people experience what's called ptosis or droopy eye after the procedure. That actually typically resolves after about 3 months. And people who are more at risk for complications from eyelid surgery are people who have chronic medical conditions, namely diabetes, high blood pressure, problems with blood clotting. When you see the doctor though and talk about if this procedure is right for you, they're gonna go over your medical history and they're gonna be able to counsel you on, you know, the likelihood of these risks based on your medical history. So that's definitely an important piece of it. But I don't want you guys to be scared off from it, hearing these potential complications. If you are a candidate for this procedure, these risks are very low in the hands of a skilled surgeon. What can you expect after the procedure? Pretty much everyone is going to have some swelling after the procedure. The amount of swelling will vary from person to person. Your surgeon will likely advise you to do the following: to apply cold compresses to the eyelids for the first 24 hours. After the first 24 hours, you have a 24-hour period in which you do nothing, and then the third 24-hour period, you are going to apply warm compresses. Your surgeon will also give you an ophthalmic ointment to apply to the incision 3 times a day for about a week. In 90% of cases, the swelling that you're going to experience will resolve within 4 or 5 days. Overall, it's about 2 weeks of downtime after the procedure, and you will have to follow up with your doctor after the procedure, with the surgeon, to have your visual fields assessed, see how you're healing, all of those things. So it is a procedure with a bit of downtime to it. The results that you get from a blepharoplasty will last about a decade. It's not going to stop the aging process, however. but it definitely will correct what you have at baseline, and the results last a good chunk of time. Of all of the procedures I'm going to talk about in this video, blepharoplasty is the one that, while it's the most invasive because you have tissue cut out, and while it's, you know, more costly than some of these other things, it definitely yields the most drastic results, the most striking results, I'll say, and the results are the most long-lasting of all of these procedures. Blepharoplasty is appropriate for people whose droopy eyelids are moderate to severe, especially if you have symptoms of headache and it's impacting visual fields, peripheral vision, yeah, then blepharoplasty. But if you have very, very mild droopy eyelids and you just want some rejuvenation, is there anything less invasive, less costly that you can pursue? Yes, absolutely. Number two thing that you might think about or discuss with your ophthalmologist, or plastic surgeon, or your dermatologist is something called a thread lift. What is this? It is a non-invasive treatment in which basically sutures, stitches, are placed under the skin. These are dissolvable and no tissue is removed, meaning there's no cutting, there's no excision of skin, fat, muscle. And the sutures are put under the skin and they are basically used to tack up the skin, just underneath the skin. So what this ends up doing is two things. It temporarily, you know, lifts things up, but the threads themselves, they provoke a healing response, which ultimately leads to an increase in collagen production. Because it stimulates an increase in collagen production, what you can expect with a thread lift is a very gradual, ongoing improvement in skin firmness. It's not as though all of a sudden overnight your skin is going to be firmer. You have to wait for the collagen induction to occur. But with time, you will start to see firmer skin. And when it comes to the upper eyelid area, you may, you know, slowly begin to appreciate less of a redundancy there with that saggy, droopy eyelid. The thread lift is a very low risk procedure. There's no risk of like scarring or bruising or bleeding. I mean, they're just putting sutures under the skin and anchoring the skin up. And then with time, you get that increase in collagen production that improves skin firmness. However, the lift that you get with a thread lift, it's only like a millimeter. So it's not the best option for people whose droopy eyelid is moderate to severe, especially, you know, if you're in that category again, where it's impacting your visual fields, then a thread lift is probably not your best bet. This is something that tends to be a better option for people, again, who have a mild droop and are younger, you know, maybe in their 30s. Whereas a blepharoplasty might be something that you might want to consider in your 40s or your 50s, and especially if you have a more profound droop. A thread lift lasts about 3 years, so it's not permanent. It's not a permanent result. Nothing that I'm talking about in today's video stops the aging process. But it's a very quick procedure, less than an hour, and the downtime is much, much shorter than with surgery, just 2 to 3 days for recovery. You can expect some swelling, but beyond that, very short downtime. The next option for rejuvenating the look of the upper eyelid is going to be a resurfacing laser treatment. Now, this is less well studied in like randomized trials in comparison to blepharoplasty, and it's certainly nowhere near as involved or invasive, and it's not going to yield as dramatic of a result, but it definitely can tighten the upper eyelid. This is a better option for those whose droopy eyelids is merely due to saggy skin. And there's no issue with, you know, excess fat contributing to the droopy eyelid, because with the CO2 laser, what it's going to do is stimulate collagen production in the deeper layers of the skin. And so that's really only going to help with the skin tightening piece of things. It's not going to address the fat. If a portion, you know, if part of what's going on with your droopy eyelid is redundant, lacks muscle or fatty tissue there, then, you know, that's going to be That's gonna be surgery that's gonna correct that, not a laser. Now with resurfacing lasers, you do have downtime. There is a risk of post-inflammatory hyperpigmentation. Preoperatively, we can kind of prep the area by prescribing hydroquinone and retinol, tretinoin. Both of these can reduce the risk of post-inflammatory hyperpigmentation with resurfacing laser. And the other risk with resurfacing laser is milia forming. Scarring is a risk here, and then you have a risk of the lid retracting and not functioning properly. These are, rare, but potential risks. With resurfacing laser, you have to assess efficacy at 6 months, because one thing that happens is you do get some swelling and it takes a while for that to kind of resolve. And so you may think that things are much, much better, but it's really just the accumulation of swelling there. Once the swelling has gone down, you can really get a sense of the improvement that you are going to expect with a resurfacing laser. This is not a permanent solution, it's a temporary kind of fix, but it definitely can rejuvenate the look of the upper eyelid, namely by tightening the area and smoothing out textural irregularities. There are some newer energy-based devices, namely radiofrequency and ALT therapy, that are used for skin tightening that show promise in rejuvenating the look of the upper eyelid. The way these work is they deliver heat to the deeper layers of the skin, creating kind of controlled areas of micro-injury that stimulate healing, collagen production, and ultimately can lead to a skin tightening effect. So that's desirable for the upper eyelid where you have some saggy skin. Examples of radiofrequency devices include Illuma, LuxIR, and Thermage. They take about 15 minutes, relatively painless, no downtime. The results are pretty modest, I would say. Not very striking, but again, if you have very, very, very mild droopiness, it may be an option for you and something that gets you the results that you're looking for. What about Botox? Botox actually is a temporary option to rejuvenate the look of saggy upper eyelids, especially in people whose sagginess is very, very mild. I think this is a better option for people and maybe in their 30s as opposed to those in their 40s or 50s, because it's really just kind of temporarily lifting things up. It's commonly referred to as a Botox brow lift. Very low risk, but again, it's not a permanent fix whatsoever, but if you are just bothered by the appearance of the beginning stages of droopy eyelids, then this might be something that you would be happy to have and enjoy the results. With Botox, results can last, up to 6 months, and then, you get repeat injections. So that may be something that's more sustainable for you, and you may be a better candidate for Botox than something more invasive like surgery, especially, again, if you're younger and the droopiness is very, very mild. And then last but not least, you can consider filler. As I said in the beginning of the video, portion of why this occurs is due to age-related loss of volume. So replacing some of that volume with a hyaluronic acid filler can actually improve the look of mildly droopy eyelids. It's not a permanent fix, and it's not going to be like the best option for people whose droopiness is more on the severe spectrum of things to the point where they're getting headaches. But filler is definitely a temporary fix that can rejuvenate the look of the eyelid skin. So those are the procedures that I think are most notable for hooded eyelids and droopy eyelid skin. I know a lot of you guys deal with it, and I would caution you, on the market nowadays, there's so many goofy, like fly-by-night devices that claim to help this. And there's really little to no data to support the use of those, namely like the new face thing, microcurrent. I mean, those things are not inexpensive. And to me, it's like, why go after something with no data that's not cheap, as opposed to something with a lot of data that may be a little bit more expensive? To each their own, but I don't recommend the new face or anything like that. I just think that there's no data for that. It doesn't even, there's not even a mechanism there. it's likely, whatever benefit people see with that, it's likely very, very temporary, which, you know, whatever. I mean, if you want to do that, fine, but I don't recommend that to people. I think some of these procedures that I mentioned are probably a better option, and it's just better to talk to a physician who, you know, specializes in this, so that you kind of know what you're dealing with, the nature of your droopy eyelids. I think with aesthetics, it's kind of odd because, you know, with any medical issue, people don't just go to their doctor and say, you know, I mean, sometimes they do, but they don't really just go to the doctor and say, hey, I want my appendix out. You know, they go to the doctor with a complaint. The doctor talks about the symptoms and figures out the source of the complaint and tells them the best treatment. And you should think about your aesthetics that way too. Because, you know, it's easy to think that your hooded eyelids are due to whatever, but it could actually be something more with your brow. You know, different procedures, different things are going to be better for you. So it's certainly more worth your effort to at least have a consultation with an oculoplastics ophthalmologist if it's really bothering you. Because then you can at least get a sense of what you're dealing with and what you might expect from different procedures based on what you're dealing with, the cost, the downtime. I think that goes a lot further. Also, you know, people are really keen on facial exercises for all sorts of stuff. I mean, yeah, no, there's no data for that. For facial exercises, facial yoga. I mean, it's cool if you want to spend your time doing that. It's free. Unlikely to harm you, but if you are to the point where your droopy eyelids are obscuring your vision, facial exercises are not the answer. So yeah, I don't think the facial exercise thing is worthwhile. As with everything in the skin though, there are some lifestyle things that certainly carry you a long way in terms of prevention and keeping what you have intact. Eating a healthy diet, not relying on sugary processed foods. Remember, sugary processed foods, they generate advanced glycation end products that, you know, affect our collagen and the deeper layers of the skin. Getting good rest so that your skin can heal and repair at nighttime. Managing your stress so those stress hormones are not all out of whack. Impairing healing. Don't smoke. That's a fast way to annihilate your skin. Don't drink alcohol in excess. Alcohol consumption in excess is associated with more prominent signs of aging of the skin, including deeper wrinkles. So don't drink too much. Don't smoke. Same things I always tell you guys. And of course, protect your eyes from the sun. Wearing sunglasses. Always put sunscreen on your eyelids. You know, protect what you have and do the best you can with lifestyle factors in the meantime. I hope this video was helpful though, and just kind of clarifying the different types of treatments for droopy eyelids. If you liked it, give it a thumbs up, share it with your friends, and as always, don't forget, sunscreen and subscribe. I'll talk to you guys tomorrow. Bye.